Let us spend some time in prayer listening to our gathering music. Once again, welcome everyone to our service of worship today. Welcome to all of you in our sanctuary. Welcome to everyone at home on Zoom in their own personal sanctuaries. Today is a celebration, a festival. Today we celebrate the Transfiguration of our Lord, the last Sunday in this season of Epiphany. This coming Wednesday, we begin the season of Lent with Ash Wednesday. But today we're still in Epiphany as we continue to learn who this one born in a manger in Bethlehem is. And today, once again, we hear the voice of God in our gospel story, telling us that Jesus is God's chosen and we should listen to him. Our service this morning continues with our opening song.
Praising the Lord, hallelujah, everybody praise the Lord. Praising the Lord, hallelujah, everybody praise the Lord. Praise God with the sound of the trumpet, praise God with the lute and the harp, praise God with the timbrel and dancing, praise God wherever you are. Praising the Lord, everybody praise the Lord. Praising the Lord, hallelujah. Everybody praise the Lord. Praise God with holy symbols. Praise God with strings and with lyres. Praise God with clashing cymbals. Praise God with all of your might. Praising the Lord, hallelujah. Everybody praise the Lord. Praising the Lord, hallelujah. Everybody praise the Lord. Praise God on top of the mountains. Praise God by day and night. Praise God down in the low valleys. Praise God because it's all right. Praising the Lord, hallelujah. Everybody praise the Lord. Praising the Lord, hallelujah, everybody praise the Lord.
Let us stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Let us pray. Holy God, mighty and immortal, you are beyond our knowing, yet we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. Transform us into the likeness of your Son, who renewed our humanity so that we may share in his divinity. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
To invite children to come forward. Well, hi there. How are you doing today?
It's Pastor Tom.
Yeah. Can you tell me your name? How old are you? Do you know? Can you show me how many fingers? Oh, I see you starting to. 2 years old. That's wonderful. Well, your grandpa told me that your name was Antonio. So welcome, Antonio. Did I get that right? Yeah? Well, today, maybe I'll ask your grandpa to help you answer some of these questions. But today I wanted to ask you if you could invite somebody really special over to your house, who would it be?
Gaga. Would that be Gaga?
Who would that be? I know you. Would it be your grandpa? Or maybe you have a different name for your grandpa.
Yeah.
Well, I bet if you were to invite somebody over to your house, you might be really excited if they were to come over, right? Yeah, you'd be really happy and excited to see them. And the reason I tell you this is because this morning we're going to hear a story about a few of Jesus' good friends named Peter, James, and John. And they were so excited because they got to spend some time with their best friend, Jesus. Jesus invited them to go on a hike up to the top of a mountain. Have you ever been on a hike?
I've been home with my mom and dad.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So these guys, they're so excited to go on this hike with Jesus.
Because I'm my baby girl.
Oh, you have a baby sister?
No.
No?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's great. Where is she?
At home.
Oh, she's at home. Of course she is. Of course she is. What's her name? Adrian?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That's great. Well, Jesus was on this hike up to the top of the mountain, and he was so excited to have Jesus all by himself, to have Jesus with them without all the crowds around him. And they go up to the top of the mountain, and they get there, and then something really special happens. Yeah. They see two more people that they had no idea were going to show up. These guys named Moses and Elijah, people who they had never seen in their whole lives, were suddenly standing there with Jesus. Yeah, exactly. And not only that, but then they heard the voice of God. They didn't see God, but they heard God say, "This is my son," referring to Jesus, "my chosen. Listen to him. Listen to him." Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So they were so excited about this event. And it would be similar in a way to maybe when somebody special for you visits. Yeah, yeah. And what's even more special for us is Jesus is with us all the time. Jesus lives in our heart and is always with us, and Jesus loves us so very much. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves your grandpa. Jesus loves everybody here and everyone in the whole world. Jesus loves. Okay, can you fold your hands and bow your head and let us pray? Dear God, we give you thanks that you live with us. You are with us wherever we are, wherever we go. In the whole world, you are always with us, loving us. Help us to share that love with others. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Okay, let's
go back. So great to see you, Antonio.
Thank you. Then we have such a hope, we act with great boldness, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory that was being set aside. But their minds were hardened. Indeed, to this very day, when they hear the reading of the Old Covenant, that same veil is still there, since only in Christ is it set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is a freedom. And all of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word, but by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us stand for the reading of the gospel.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go?
Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 9th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up to the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen, listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen. Beginning in the mid-1990s, I became a huge fan of the New Testament scholar Marcus Borg. At the time, I was struggling in my faith, trying to understand how Jesus and how the various views of Jesus in the New Testament fit together. I was in searching mode and came upon his book, Meeting Jesus Again for the First Time. I was inspired and enlightened by this book. He helped me, Marcus Borg helped me make sense of the different views of the significance of Jesus in the New Testament. And from there, I went on to read his other books on Jesus and his books on living the Christian faith. Well, I was recently thinking about Marcus Borg and one of the distinctions he likes to make in his work. In the book Meaning of Jesus, The Meaning of Jesus, Borg writes about the relationship of history remembered, and history metaphorized. History remembered and history metaphorized. Borg's point is that there are actual things that happen that are remembered and turned into stories, like Jesus being transfigured on the top of the mountain. And for Borg, obsessing about what exactly happened or denying that it could have happened is a waste of time and energy. Our efforts are better spent looking at how the people who remembered the story made use of that story to teach religious and spiritual truths, that is, the metaphor that they made from the remembered history. It's a distinction that makes sense to me. History turned into metaphor, or personal stories turned into metaphor. And isn't it part of what any of us try to do when we tell a story? I know Catherine will tell a story, and I'll wonder if I was actually there because of the way she tells the story. But the facts aren't important, I keep telling myself. It's the point of the story, the metaphor of the story. And just because you teach spiritual truth using a story doesn't mean the story isn't factual. It just means that sometimes the facts are beside the point. So I'm assuming there's a real and remembered moment underneath this story of the Transfiguration. I also assume that figuring out the actual facts of that moment are impossible. There can be all kinds of speculation as to what did or didn't happen, but no real way of knowing for sure. So what about this story we just heard? What are the metaphorical truths contained within what happened? What does this account tell us about God? And what does it tell us about ourselves and our lives of faith? Well, I believe it tells us that there are peak experiences in our spiritual lives. We all know they do happen, and we can never predict them, create them, or repeat them in exactly the same way again. They just seem to happen when God wants them to happen. Our worship service, what we're all involved with right now, at its best, hopes to stimulate a similar experience. But such a thing will always, or most always, be just a facsimile of the real experience. I think this account also tells us that spiritual highs come and go, but the real spiritual life is lived in the ordinary day to day to day. In chapters 4 through 8 of the Gospel of Luke, Jesus goes off alone to pray 5 times. The first time was the temptation in the wilderness. And of course, that wasn't exactly a spiritual high. In the other 4 times, Jesus goes off to pray. Nothing happens. Well, sort of nothing. Jesus gets interrupted over and over, telling him, "Hey, Jesus, people want to see you." But in none of those go off alone and pray episodes did Jesus change his form or hear heavenly voices. Jesus just prayed. And that's the point. The first 8 chapters of Luke tell the story of Jesus just going about his business of preaching and teaching and healing, with times of worship in the synagogue and times of private prayer. This was his life. Long periods of ordinariness, with only an occasional moment of luminosity. Pastor F. Arnold Bavendam, served St. Matthew's German Evangelical Lutheran Church in Jersey City, New Jersey, from 1900 until he died in 1950. I was the pastor there from 1993 to 2000. And one Saturday, members of the congregation were cleaning out the basement of the church building. Late in the afternoon, I came across an old wooden cabinet along one of the walls in the basement. And lo and behold, it was filled with a collection of Pastor Bavendam's sermons. These were stacks of about 6 inches by 5 inches, almost square sheets of 7 or 8 pages stapled together. These were his sermons, and they were stacked up in that wooden cabinet. Some were in German, but most of them were in English, as Pastor Bavendam was called to lead the English language service that would be starting up twice a month in that German Lutheran congregation. Well, fascinated, I began skimming through these sermons. Well, in one of his old sermons, he talked about going on a trip in his car, a Model T, to the Pocono Mountains in Pennsylvania. And some of the time he had to drive along creek beds because there wasn't a road. And at other times he had to back his car up to the top of the mountain because the car didn't have a fuel pump. And occasionally on the top of the mountain he would reach the top there and he could look out over the beautiful Pocono Mountains. Well, we would probably say hills, but back east they call them mountains. Looking out over the beautiful Pocono Mountains and being inspired. But most of his time was spent in the valleys. Well, Pastor Bavendam compared this in this sermon to our lives of faith. We catch occasional glimpses of inspiration, glimpses of the holy. But mostly, it's plodding through the shadows of the valleys. God is constantly present in all of our lives. Our awareness of that presence of God is mostly a matter of perception, of trusting that God is indeed with us, not only in those moments of inspiration, of glimpses of the holy, of those moments of high feeling and intense spirit, but God is certainly with us through those yawning and lonely valleys of life. It's a matter of paying attention to God, looking for God in those ordinary moments of our everyday lives, of looking for God in the most simplest of circumstances. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Mountain to be alone, how it will cause you.
Let us pray. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all God has made. Transform us by your greatness, O God. Send us down the mountain to share joy with all people. Make us agents of change, confident that your hope will vanquish despair and your goodness will conquer evil. God of grace,
we bring our prayer to you.
The mountains and valleys sing your praise. Dazzle us with your presence in every landscape, bluffs built by ancient glaciers, canyons carved by flowing rivers, and horizons with uninterrupted views, and sands shaped by ocean tides. God of grace,
we bring our prayer to you.
Lord of the nations, the horrors of war stand before us. Deep concerns grips us for the safety of Ukrainians in harm's way. Sorrow washes over us for the senselessness of war and the losses that come with it. Come to the aid of nations and leaders who need your guidance. Come to the aid of those standing in harm's way. Bring healing to the wounded and comfort to the dying and bereaved. We pray for an end to this conflict and hope for peace on earth. Lasting peace. God of grace,
we bring our prayer to you.
Heal those who are in distress. Give patience to those waiting for answers. Grant hope to those who have reached the limits of treatment. We lift up Bunny Mueller, Florinda Madol, Siggy Yurik, Dorothy Griffith, Neva Conrad, Christy McCormick, Judy Hansen, the Reed family, Bob and LaVon Baylor, Althea Shanks, the Aney family, Carol and Hal Shirley, Vern and Laura, Mary and Jeff, Jane, Annegret, Rose, Marie, and all those we name out loud or hold in the quiet of our hearts. Give compassionate hearts to those who accompany loved ones through illness and uncertainty. God of grace,
we bring our prayer to you.
Today we shout Alleluia from the mountaintop. This week, we enter the wilderness of Lent. Bless all who prepare and lead us in worship during this change of season, pastors, deacons, musicians, and all who contribute to our worship life. God of grace,
we bring our prayer to you.
Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us stand. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Would you share that peace with one another? Peace, peace, Paul. Peace, peace, everyone. Peace, peace. Peace. You may be seated. Just a couple of announcements I'd like to highlight. First of all, please take note of the announcements that will be up on the screen at the end of the service. Secondly, as you heard, this Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, and we will be having a service here, a service of the imposition of ashes at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. Now, for those at home who will not be able to make it to the 7 o'clock service, I will be doing the imposition of ashes down on the sidewalk from 3:30 to 5 p.m. So folks are welcome to drive up in their car and receive the imposition of ashes on Ash Wednesday. Let us then prepare for Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. Holy One, the beginning and the end, the giver of life, blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your son Jesus, the Word made flesh. And now I invite those at home to raise their piece of bread. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." For those at home, I invite you to eat of the bread of life. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For those at home, I invite you to drink of the cup of salvation. Lord Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Here at Marin Lutheran Church, everyone is welcome to come forward for Holy Communion. You will be invited to come up the center aisle, where you will receive a piece of bread, and then as you move to your right, you will see the tray of small cups of wine and grape juice. The grape juice is lighter in color. Come to God's table. There is a place for you and enough for everyone.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, gracious God, for we have feasted on the abundance of your house. Send us to bring good news and to proclaim your favor to all, strengthened with this richness of your grace in your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you and who calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Amen. You may be seated.
Into a weary world, share the good news.
Thanks be to God.